to do your best to win the prize for the competition.
If you can understand everything that you've just been talking about. So I would like to get into the topic how to pitch your ideas, basically how to sell ideas. And it's not something that you don't know. I'm sure you all do that thing, that selling ideas. And that's what we want to cover basically in the next hour, or maybe shorter, and try to run through it fast. So first is, what is pitching, and then what is the difference between pitching and presenting? And there's a couple of formulas. I always get asked, you know, when there's something new, it's like, so how do you do it? Give me the recipe, give me the formula how to do this. So I found one you can use. And then I love icebergs. They really help to understand a lot of things around pitching. Then there's the five key topics, or the key stops, as I call them. And then actually, if you're joining the hackathon, and I hope you all will, there are two pitches that you will have to do. So we'll see what these are. So let's start with what pitching actually is. Where does this word come from? And it's actually, it means there's a lot of other meanings, but in sports, it means throwing your ball, aiming your ball, and this is how it looks like. And it's not just finding that direction you need to throw it to, but it means that somebody needs to catch it. So I'll try to do a quick pitch about who I am and see if you're catching the ball. I have a couple of numbers here that have to do with me. And I just start at the top here. This big number here means money that I've lost in a venture before. This is the kilometers that are currently on my e-bike. I've worked with 195 engineering teams at the Technical University of Vienna, working on their projects. We had a whole semester though, and not a hackathon time frame. Make it happen again. There's about 100 organizations or so I've worked with in the innovation space. I've written and authored 27 articles and 5 books. I've worked independently as a self-employed person for more than 25 years. I've lived in 14 cities across 7 countries and 3 continents. I've worked for the Austrian Ministry of Education for 13 years. 12 years at the University of Technology in Vienna. I have 2 passions. One is technology and the other one is nature. And I have 1 cat. So now you know a lot of things about me already. And I hope I could capture your attention and your willingness, your openness to accept advice from me. So let's keep on going and try to separate and distinguish what is the difference between a pitch and a presentation. Especially having a lot of people from research, you're probably usually on the presentation side. So you're trying to give an overview, a comprehensive overview about something that you've worked upon, and you're trying to explain everything. How you got there, what results you already had, and you have a lot of time, so it's usually at least 15 minutes maybe that you have to explain something to someone. And It's for example to show that you are a thought leader, like in the TED Talks, for example, or you want to be creating awareness or visibility, or you want to educate other people about what you do. But a pitch is something totally different. It's a targeted sales pitch that focuses on specific aspects of what you'll be doing, but only a few of them. And the goal is to get a direct conversation with the people that you are pitching to. So you want them to act. And you have very little time. So it even starts at 30 seconds sometimes. And maximum, it's a luxury if you have several minutes. And your only goal is that you want to be remembered. The only person that people should remember is you. They have to remember you with your pitch, come to you and act according to the way you want them to act. So seeing this difference, it's quite clear that you have to use storytelling to engage with that audience. So it's actually the most important task for you when you pitch to someone to know who they are. And that's even 90% of your efforts and your time that you should invest in this. Know what their backgrounds are, what are their interests, what do they burn for, and how can you be part of their future with them. So this leaves you about maybe 3 to 5 maximum points that you can get across in a pitch that somebody actually remembers at the end. So remembering our goal, we want to be the person that is remembered. So I don't know if you have ever heard about the word or the term elevator pitch. Yes, how many, who has heard about it? Okay. So this is quite clear, right? You have the time it takes to go from the floor you're at to the desired one, and at the end you have a deal. So here's a small recipe for what an elevator pitch structure can look like. So it includes that you have your target customers and your customer need named, the product maybe, the category it is in, the benefits of course, and the competition. So how do we do that? Here's one of the formulas. It's actually coming out of the marketing theory, and it's easy to remember if you're a musician, especially this opera Aida. And AIDA stands for attract, interest, desire, and act. So you first have to attract the person's attention, make them interested in what you're telling them, and even more so, make them desire to really be part of whatever you want them to do, and then say, yes, I'm in. So here's another formula that I found that is very useful in getting you focusing on the topics that you need to include. So it's this NABC pitch method, and that was, okay, it's coming out of an institute that has basically made this a standard, so it's not really anything else than just an acronym for a process. So the N stands for the need. So what is the need you're fulfilling? And the approach you're going to do that with, what's the benefit for your customers or the beneficiaries, and who is in competition to what you're building? So now I want to make the reference back to what you have learned just before. For me, it's really difficult to stay on that mind level of the pure technology. And the reason is that we all are emotional beings. And we need to set our ideas. So it's about whatever we are creating with the technology needs to benefit someone. So that's where we have to become emotional and really understand what the problem is we are solving, for who, and who else is doing that right now already, and how we can do that in a better way. So here is a small recipe as well of, you know, how much of the time you need to devote to those points. So the very first one is the hook, it's like A, once you remember they are tracked. And then you can see that, you can read that yourself. And by the way, I'll be more than happy to send this PowerPoint to you so that you can go through it, because I'm quite doing a fast speaking through it. What's really important is in your descriptions that you are quantitative and not qualitative. So if you imagine you have investors in front of you or people from a company, they always want to know the business case. So it's not enough if you say, well, this is a huge market or the market is growing. If you have numbers there, it's really great. And don't worry, this is all assumptions, this is an estimation, so nobody will nail you down on those numbers. Nevertheless, you know, now we spoke about how to pitch something, and it's quite on a high level, as you all understand, compared to when you do research and you really go down to the bottom of things. You still have to know all the answers that are behind those statements that you make. And as we have heard very much at the beginning, if you don't have the answers, pretend you have the answers. Especially in a hackathon, it's really about believing in your idea. And it's very, very often the case that teams do not finish, but that doesn't stop you from having a pitch. Many times also, it's not really an MVP, a minimum viable product, but it's just a fake demonstration of it. But if you convince the jury or your investors, it's fine, you can build it afterwards, right? So now I'm coming to the icebergs. I don't know if you've been able to read that at, when I was pitching myself, there was also a line saying that I'm the founder and organizer of the Fuck Up Nights in Basel. I hope many of you have heard about Fuck Up Nights. Does it sound familiar to some of you? No? Well, this iceberg here also has that failure written right down here, you know, and you know that in research or anything we actually learn, we always fail. It's not like, you know, you start something new and it works right away. There is this learning process you have to go through. And the Fuck Up Nights movement is a couple of people in Mexico City about 5.5 years ago who have said, we don't want to speak about best practice examples anymore. We want to speak about our fuck ups and what we have learned. So they started to meet on a regular basis and just discuss that, just like a shandish or a regular stable. And this has spread. So 5.5 years later, there's 250 cities in the world where they're doing the Fuck Up Nights. And I just had one in Basel last Thursday, and there was a couple of weeks ago one in Zurich at the ETH Entrepreneurship Club. So if you happen to run across one, I recommend you to go in. It's a really fun time. And it also has some emotional parts, of course, because learning from failure always means overcoming your frustration and your all kinds of feelings, anger maybe that come, to be able to turn it around, that iceberg, and see the positive lesson in it. So now I want to show you a little video. I don't know what just happened here, so it's a link here. It's just to make you look at an iceberg maybe from a different perspective.
It's so difficult.
did that catch your attention? So see, that was just a couple of seconds. And I think it is a really smart way. I love this. I can see this over and over. Actually, if you look for it online, you'll find a couple of other examples with the same message. It's safer to travel in groups. But they abuse the iceberg to protect them. So I basically started to use this iceberg and said, okay, let's turn them around, you know. The original concept of the iceberg is from Sigmund Freud, and he created that to let people understand, you know, our conscious mind, which is on the top, and below the waterline is our unconscious mind. So I would like you to think about the iceberg when you're pitching. So it feels maybe a little bit more comfortable, so it's not that you're ignoring all the things you know. You're just choosing to take only the top of the iceberg and package that into a story that fits for the audience you're pitching to. Okay? So, I said, even though we are pitching only a story to catch the hearts of the of your audience, you need to know all the answers. So I want to quickly run through five areas that are really crucial for presenting an idea that's maybe even a business plan or, you know, has developed into a startup idea. And these are the five topics that investors or anybody who wants to buy your idea need to be convinced about. So first is the team, then it's of course your idea, the market, partnerships, and the business models. And I'll jump right into the team and explain you why the team is even before the idea. And the why is that there is actually statistics that say that the competencies, abilities, and your personalities in your teams, they rank higher than the idea itself. So you really have to let this sink into you and understand that it's not really the idea that is so important to someone who invests in you, but it's you as a team and your capacities, your knowledge, your skills to develop something that is more valuable than the idea itself. So the questions they will ask you are these, no? Who are you, you know, who is in your team? What are the reasons for you to be in that team together? And how in the hell do you think that you can get this done? So here's the iceberg again, the team iceberg basically. So it's, you have that dream team and everybody will be you know, feeling on this level, but you have all these other things below, you know, you have your personalities, you have habits, your beliefs, you have a lot of things that are not so visible to each other, you know, especially when you meet the very first time on a hackathon. Be aware of all that, you know, part of that iceberg that is below that. Because ultimately it's about being able to work together, right? And we want to avoid that this happens in the end, right? So my recommendation at this point is always to you know, really be explicit about your feelings, your thoughts, and be very open to the people in your team. And that's why hackathons are so great. And I'm actually a hackathon maniac. I've organized lots of hackathons and been part of it. And I'm warning you, if you have been to a hackathon once, you will always want to go to hackathons. Because it's contagious. It's that open work atmosphere with other people that really is so attractive. So there's of course, you know, lots of rules of, you know, how you can work together, and I'm sure you have experienced most of them. So I'll just leave that as a reading task for. or later. But then there's also this theory about how teams develop. And that's a really important one to also understand and maybe read into before. So it starts with forming, storming, norming, and performing. And then there's also a fifth stage, which is actually mourning, you know, when your team is falling apart or when the hackathon is over. This is what I've heard from all of the teams that have been, you know, really working well together. They just miss that afterwards. So it can feel like you're falling into a black hole after the hackathon when your team is suddenly not around you anymore. The importance here is to see this graph here as well, which is the motivation and the productivity in the phases of the team forming phases. So you can see that the motivation at the beginning is the highest, of course, there's always enthusiasm, and it goes down very quickly. So this is the stages that you will be going through in your teams at the hackathon. So there's always a lot of failure involved, especially when you're in these high speeds, you know, going through all these stages here. And so I want to do a quick reality check on, you know, how often does this actually happen? And maybe you've heard this, but, you know, 90% of startups fail. So you're, you know, there's a very low probability that you will be successful. And this is not only in hackathons, but this is also in business partnerships. And that's actually, it was even for me a surprising number, because 80% of business partnerships, and that does not only mean self-employed people that partner with each other, but it's also entire companies that are failed. Most of the time, you don't hear those stories, of course. And here's a couple of reasons why failure like this happens. So hopefully it made sense until now, and you know, really creates the understanding inside of you that these skills, these people skills, are really, really important, and that it is important to have this diversity and a variety of skills in your team to be able to be important. It's one of the main reasons why teams fail. And then establish this trust among your team members so that everybody has the control and as well the responsibility for the tasks that they own. And as I said before, the team is much more important than the idea, and this is what's coming out here again. There's so much change in the market in our times now. And ideas change and markets change very fast, but the people are the ones who hold it together and who continue to build an adaptive product. So the most important thing is that you need to build on each other's strengths and balance out the weaknesses with you, with yourself and inside the team. So knowing yourself to start with is the most important factor here. There's something about you know, knowing ourselves. I don't know if you have ever come across this Lohari window. It's kind of mapping out, you know, how much you know about yourself and how much do others know about you. So in the left top, it's quite easy to understand, and you know, it's known to yourself, but it's also known to others. And then there's also this area that you know, but others don't know. But on the right side now, it's becoming you know, a little more difficult here. There's a part which is unknown to yourself and also to others, so that's fine, because nobody knows. But this part up here, that is not known to yourself, but others know it, it's called the blind spot. And this is really, really important for everyone to understand, you know, where are our blind spots. And that's what you also learn in hackathons, if you get that feedback from other people. Not only positive feedback, but maybe not so good feedback or something you've never noticed. So this is a very big potential for you to learn about yourself. So then there's lots of tests, of course. You know, if we're speaking about knowing ourselves, that maybe if you apply for jobs with companies, you ask to do tests, and they're usually very expensive, these tests. So, but I still would like you to really remember always that even companies would need to be focusing on your strengths, the strengths you're bringing in, because statistics say that you're 6 times more likely to be good in your job, to be engaged. And even for us, as non-working people, it is showing in statistics that we have 3 times more likely better life and excellent quality of life if we build on our strengths. So what I can recommend here, if you have questions here or want to kind of explore your strengths, is the Gallup Strength Finder. And this is an expert I partner with, because this test is quite inexpensive. It's $25 online. And I'm showing you this because I wish I would have found out about this test about 25 years ago. Because these 5 strengths that I got back from this test were something I've never thought about. And so it would be very good for you to dive into this. You can contact me on that, of course. And then there's also my very, very good friend and partner, Sabine. You've seen her around. She is an expert in teaching you how to understand, to get yourself in this high-performance mode, in this hyper-energy state that you will be in the hackathon. This is a very, very intensive time. And how to care for your body, mind, and soul there, it's a really important factor. So now I get to the idea. And here are the questions that you will be asked about your idea. Very important one is this why at the top here. Why do you think the world needs your idea? What problem are you solving? And what resources do you need for doing this? Here's the iceberg again. You have your genius idea on the top, but you have all these different topics that you need to know below that. What are your substitutes out there on the market? Is anybody else doing this already and differently? So many marketing-related questions. And there's again bad news. New products fail also in 80% of the cases. So this is not only true for startups, but that is true for any organization. And to make that a little bit more visible, this is how it looks like if you look at it across the phases in the product development. So you can see actually that quite a lot of the products even go into development and testing, and that means that there's a lot of money that has been put into this before they fail. And if you look at it in terms of numbers of raw ideas that you need to get to one successful product, it's quite a lot. So 20,000 to have one successful product on the market. So I don't know if you would be able to do this at the hackathon. So that's what I've already mentioned before. It is really, really important that this hackathon is a very short amount of time, a very intense amount of time. And all these things that I've mentioned until now is what you will be facing in this hackathon. So it's really important to basically manage those expectations and dreams you come with, and to really understand where you want to go. And where you want to go as a team in this time, in this short period of time that you have together. And then how to get there, of course, who is doing what, and how to get to that result. So goal setting is really important. And of course everybody knows what a goal is, right? it's observable, it's measurable, and that time frame is there, so it's, the hackathon is just 30 hours, and you should have that result, and it should hit in the middle, right? So I've also found another formula for you to remember how to create these goals. And I don't know if you heard about SMART goals before. The S is standing for specific, very detailed, measurable, achievable, realistic, and within your time frame. This is something that I have, I think probably the most touched topic at my university course, to really be able to take that idea of what you want to reach and shape it into a form or model that you can actually create in these 30 hours that you have. And here again, I would like to remind you of that word change. Even if you have a solid plan and everything has been put down in a specific, measurable way, there will be change. So this is another question that will come up, sending you ideas. You have a vision. What's the vision behind that product or service that you are creating? Or a mission? And where is the purpose? And what is actually your message? So I hope I have confused you now, because these topics are, you know, probably more familiar to business people. And I'd like to try to sort this out with you and make you understand why this is important and what is the difference actually between them. So the highest, I would say, in a pyramid is the purpose. It's your why statement. Why are you doing what you're doing? What's behind this blockchain contract? What are you trying to achieve? And your vision is describing that future state when you got there. What did you achieve, basically? What is different in the world reaching that vision? And the mission is defined as something that you actually do getting there. Thank you. And the message is actually the thing, maybe a lot of things start with what you can say to a group. It's maybe that product or service that you want to build. So to be really practical here, I'll give you an example. That's one of my student teams. And they built or had the technology where they wanted to be able to take part in a soccer club, in the match of your soccer favorite soccer club virtually. They didn't want to go there because there's always too many people and maybe the tickets are expensive. They wanted to take part virtually. So the mission then would be, I've turned this now upside down, okay? We had the purpose on the top first. Now I've turned it upside down. The mission is that we give you the tools to watch a soccer match virtually. The vision, a little bit bigger than that, is that you will never miss a match of your favorite soccer club anymore. And now, to the purpose, to the top of that pyramid, is actually that we have the technology to make virtual just as real of a live attendance, being part of something in a virtual way, just as being there actually as a person. And maybe you can see that now, and I know this needs you to read this again, definitely. Maybe the product and service you have created is something very specific and something focused, because you have that limited amount of time and you have limited skills available in your team as well, maybe. But if you go back to that purpose, is that with this technology that you have created, you can not only take part in a soccer match virtually, you can take part in anything virtually. So you have created a technology that can do much more than you first set out to create. So even though we know all this now, and there will be things going wrong, and that will be you at some point in the hackathon when things don't go the way you want. And then just take it the way it comes, you know, stay cool and be open for it and have an open discussion and find a way how to turn the iceberg around. And that failure may be something that doesn't work, and continue. I'm sure maybe some of you are hopefully I've heard that, you know, what fear is actually standing for. False evidence appearing real. Okay, that is important. So, stay positive and keep on working on it. And quickly jumping now into the market. What's the market for your product and service that you are creating? Market is again the audience that you are pitching to, that you are selling your idea to. What do these people gain? What do they pay for? What are they willing to pay for? And how does this customer look like? Here's the iceberg again. On top of the iceberg, here's your brand. We had Google here today, so everybody knows Google, that's the brand. It stands for something, but it takes a lot of work to get to that, becoming known as Google, for example, or even smaller companies. So marketing is basically that struggle between production and engineering. You can say, we can make this, we can create this, and the marketing people, the sales people that say, but we can sell this, or we can't sell this, or you're creating even too much, we don't need that, we want to sell only this part. So these sales people are basically your arm through the market, and that's why it is really important to look at this site very, very early on, and integrate that into your product development, because the earlier you know about what your market needs, the better your product will be. So marketing is also about a target market, and a target market means a very specific part of an entire big market, maybe the market in Switzerland for a certain kind of product. And that's a really, really important thing to understand. If you believe your product serves everyone, it's equals that your product doesn't serve anyone. It's basically you're not able to reach a big market. On a very practical side, you can only target a very focused group of people that you can effectively reach. So this well-defined target market is very, very important, and it definitely needs to be part of your pitch if you're standing in front of investors that want to give you money, because they want to see that money very fast. So partnerships. And the technology, maybe partnerships is an easier topic because you are used to use other people's technology for APIs. So this is really important that you cannot do everything alone, of course. And but there's also other types of partnerships like alliances and across the industry that help you basically reach the target market that you have defined. Here's the iceberg again, what it all means, and you need to define your partnership strategy. Here it's also the intellectual property rights. These icebergs, by the way, of course not exclusive, you know, some of these topics, they belong in more than just one of those sections. Those five stocks, they are different. So I hope it's clear that we can actually not do it alone. And there's actually another number to confirm this. In a study asking, I think more than 4,000 executives, they have mentioned that 85% of them say that it is very, very important for the success of any kind of a business to work with partners. Now into the last model, the golden part here is the business model. And I don't know if you've heard about business model design already. But the business model is actually more important than the technology that you use or the product that you are creating. And here are the questions around this. Business model basically describes and captures how your company creates that value that needs that economic feedback and funds from the market. And how is this model fitting to different kind of contexts, maybe in other countries? And how long are you able to withstand a competition that maybe is copycatting your product? So here's the iceberg. And you see a lot of names for different kind of business models. And stated that already actually, this is the definition, the rationale of how an organization creates, delivers, and captures value. And this value here is not always only economic value in terms of money, but is also social impact and other forms of value that you create. Just to understand how these business models have changed. You know, this is kind of how it used to be in the past. You still might find this in some industries, maybe, that you know, the supplier, the creator of a product or service is selling to a customer, and the power of the supplier is much higher than your customer, and maybe eventually you get some feedback. But actually, it looks more like this. That the power of the customer has grown so much towards the supplier, so that the market conditions are such that the customers are basically choosing you as a supplier and not the other way around. And there is a very close feedback channel, and there's actually knowledge flowing in both ways. But I believe we're even closer to this, and especially in the technology space, where you can't really distinguish anymore, you know, if you're in the customer space or in the supplier, because we are now collaborating across borders and we are co-creating things. We're working with our customers on the market, and that's the model basically for this visualization. So why is this so important? Again, there's a statistic that has confirmed this, that the competition actually out there in the market is not on the product level anymore, or on the level of your technology, but it's on the business model side. And the reason is that, it's like I said, it's really easy to copy something from you. There are so many people out there who are working maybe on the same thing. In Asia, for example, in China or in India, there's, you know, lots of people, a huge amount of human resources working on the same ideas that we have here. But it is really hard if you have a business model, an entire system, how you work with your customers, and you have a community that works with you. This is something that cannot be copied just like that. So building this up is the backbone of your success. So the business model canvas is something that would help you to create that kind of a business model that you want to shape. I don't know if you've seen this. The business model canvas is used by many, many people around the world. You get that very fast also if you Google it. And it's all centered around the value proposition, in the sense that what is the value that you create? And the left side is how you create this value. So all your resources and activities and partners, and also the costs that you incur to create this value proposition. And on the right side, you have your relationships with the customers and your customers, your target market. And in case your product and service is something you really have to, you know, touch and give to someone else, you of course need a logistics channel to get it to your customers. And then the revenues that come. So this is kind of like a map that helps you create this understanding of what a business model could be. But there is a very, very helpful publication, a document that has listed all the 55 different business model patterns that are out there. And they basically say that this is it. There is no more than that out there. And everything new that comes up is a combination of those 55. So if you're interested in this, this is a very good read as well. If you are wanting to build up your created product into a startup, this is something that you have to understand and go through. So I want to end with a couple of business models explained that maybe you don't know about. I mean, everybody knows Airbnb, but it was also even new to me that they make money on two sides. They get a commission from the booking fee itself, but they also make money on the transaction side. So they have two different revenue streams where money comes in. This is a community example. It's a platform called Patients Like Me. I found this very interesting because it's something free, so there is no money actually generated through the platform itself. It's people who have rare diseases or something special that doctors could not solve. They enter their information in the platform and like this find other people who might have the same thing. So they can exchange their experiences, see what has worked for them and learn about their own diseases in this way. And the platform is selling the data, hopefully of course anonymous, and but they are making their money with selling this data to pharma companies. But you can imagine that a business model like this starts to run only when you have enough data. So you have to be able to withstand quite a period of time until your business model will be able to start working. This one is a very interesting one that I came across when I was researching for pay what you want pricing models. And I found this company called Humble Bundle, and it's a platform that sells games and ebooks. So electronic created content, and you can actually choose the price you want to pay for the products you can get there. And this is how it works. Humble Bundle is the platform for content owners, the creators of those games and the PDFs or ebooks. And they are selling this to the target market, to people who are interested in this. And then they also have a charity. They have a charity of the month they support. And for themselves, they have a percentage, a commission fee for bringing these two parties together. And when you go on their platform, basically you can see here that you can choose the price there, what you want to pay. There are some prices proposed to you, but then the price is fully open. And what's interesting for me here, I've not seen this anywhere else actually, you can choose, you know, how much of this money that you're willing to pay goes to whom. And I think this is very important technology-wise. If your business model as a pay what you want feature, your technology needs to be able to make that happen. So technology is very closely linked to your business model, and that's why it's something that could be even at the beginning of your idea, where you say, this is a completely new way we are tackling this, and it will make you money from the first step you are out there as well. This is a proposal how you could find maybe a new business model, but I'm not going into this anymore now, we are much too late. So here I will be at the end of listening, and I would like to do a small practice with you. And I don't know if we can still do that, but at least to take it with you. When you join the hackathon or any kind of hackathon, you will have two pitches ahead of you. And these two pitches are this here. The first one is that you will have to pitch your idea to find your team. Maybe you can get out of this one. If you don't want to pitch an idea, you just want to join a team, then you are the audience, basically. And at the end of the hackathon, you will have to pitch your project to the jury. So these are two different kind of pitches and require you to think of a story that you present to them in a completely different way. So my plan was to discuss this with your neighbor, you know, what is different in these two kind of pitches. So I don't know if you still want to do this or not. Do you feel up for it? A couple of minutes? Too late? Yes, I see the nodding faces.
Yeah, everybody's up for it.
Okay, just really take 1 minute and think about what is the difference. Pitching your idea to an audience of people, you want them to join you as a team, and then at the end, pitching to a jury to convince them, but they will give you the first prize. Can you come up with one element that is different about it? Great together, yeah, that's a good thing. You're on the stage and you're pitching, you're looking for your team. How, what would the story have to look like to attract those team members that you want to see? Okay, that's the pitch. You should create a story that attracts other people to come and join you in your team.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Integrate into your story how cool and innovative your idea is. But then you also want to find the people who have the right motivation to join you, right? So what kind of element you have to put into your pitch to attract the people with the right motivation? And then of course also the right skills. So probably you have to be very explicit here, you know, what are your skills and who are you looking for to join you in your team? Okay, so now if we go to the next one where it's like at the end you have now worked a weekend together for 30 hours and you have to now present to the jury. The very first and most important one, if you want to win, is to look at the evaluation criteria the jury has and put that into your story. You want to be, of course, also very clear and inspiring in the wording that you're using. And you, again, want to be, like we have started at the beginning, you want to be very memorable and visual. So it should be a very concise presentation. I'm covering this last one here. This slide is basically what's really I want to give you as the most important thing to remember, even if you don't remember anything from today. This is the jury guidelines from the Basel Hack, because I'm part of the organizers team of the Basel Hackathon, and if you get infected by the hack virus, then I would love to see you in Basel in November when we have the hackathon. But these are the guidelines here, and it's happening over and over that the teams do not look at these guidelines, even though I've been coaching all the teams to really take that to their heart and incorporate that into their pitches. And it's really making me very sad many times that a really cool project doesn't get picked by the jury because they were not able to get this across what they have done. And I think maybe especially as women like this, to not really, you know, present this in a celebrated way. And that's why really you know, take this to your heart. And even those things are not finished, appoint someone in your team to work on the pitch and to satisfy these criteria so that the jury can give you the points. Elisabetta was part of the Basel Hack jury, and she knows how hard it is then to sell a really good idea within the team of the jury members. So that's it. Thank you very, very much. I'm very happy. I'm there for questions. I'll probably be there at the hack too, and I'm happy to send you the slides as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for sticking around. That will be just literally a few last words, my final words. The probability of success is difficult to estimate, but if we never search, the chance of success is zero. You never know until you try what's going to come out of this hackathon. So I hope many of you will sign up. Two lessons, or actually three, from today are that first of all, you can go to Google Code Labs. There are tutorials, and between now and the hackathon, you can still go through them. They're step by step, will guide you and maybe give you some ideas for how you can incorporate that into your projects. About a week before a hackathon, we're planning to already post challenges so that you can start thinking about them. About blockchain, now, even though this was, I know today, a lot of information and a lot of new stuff, so you can continue with this website that Angelica showed you. It's, if you go to hackandlead.com into community partners, at the end there is a link, so you don't have to wait for us and for our email, you can just go there and click on the logo and this will take you to the website. So first two courses, they're really nice, really nicely done. You can follow on Ethereum blockchain yourself, and later on, if you want to learn more, we'll send you a form once you apply, and you can leave your email there. Now, about pitching, also the materials, the slides, we will share with you as well, so that all the information we put in this one very, very intense event, you can still use later on. And very briefly, the schedule might still change, but on the website that's of the hackathon, it looks like this. So there will be registration until 9 a.m. We do an opening session, we will announce the challenges. Again, you will have them on the website, but this will be official presentation by the sponsors. We'll do the team matching very quickly if you haven't done that before. There will be, as I mentioned an hour ago, you will still have a chance to match, find a match over Slack. So if you apply, you get accepted, we send you a link to Slack, and there you can start posting information. My name is, I am a specialist in this business, I have a great idea, or I want to join a great team. So that, from my experience, works pretty well. Many people I've seen have been doing that. So it's another way of networking. Then we do hacking, lunch, your kids will have a chance to play in parallel. There'll be tech talks in the evening, and then before 8 p.m. everybody goes home. And the next day, on Sunday, we restart. You have the whole day for hacking. With a lunch break, then the project submission deadline is 6 p.m. Via a web interface, you'll be able to submit your project. Then the jury is deciding based on the criteria whether they like your project or not. And there will be tech talks. Sorry, I forgot about the pitching. You'll be pitching and then the jury will be deciding, of course. Then there will be in parallel tech talks, and in the evening at 7 p.m. we'll be awarded prizes. I'm not going to reveal what's a prize, but it will be a surprise. And then around 7:30, 8 p.m. we wrap up the event. So I hope many of you will sign up. These are the sponsors, again, and supporting partners of the event.
Just to remember, SAS 3 is there?
Yes. So
the
yes, so out of the community partners, Zastrin, you go on our website, click on Zastrin, it brings you to the courses, blockchain courses. So these are our, I want to acknowledge all our supporting partners, all our sponsors, and all our community partners that help us reach out as many people as possible. From the target group, and we are an association, OnePlus+, non-profit organization, we do anything we can that makes sense to increase diversity in technology in the specificity scene. So feel free to write to us, talk to us, join us. We do many other events as well this year. So I hope we'll stay in touch. That's it. Thank you so much. On the way out. Let's thank our speakers. Not all of them are here around and still, but thank you so much for your time. And on your way out, please remember to pick laptop stickers. Thanks.